Welcome to another edition of Sci-Fi Journal, presented by the Rhode Island Science Fiction Club. This show is for May 2013. I'm Marc Morisseau. Also hosting the show today are Calvin Watts III and Jay Kingston.
Oh. Yeah. Right. I'm sitting here saying, I know you're over there. Why does it look like I'm going that way? But
it's a reverse image. And our friend James Incy is doing some Quidditch stuff as we speak. Riding around the
Quidditch.
Stop it. Whoa, get out of here.
Okay, fine.
Sounds good. And as always, we begin our show talking about the wonderful world of movies with a segment we call Popcorn Previews. Take it away, Jay.
Okay, great. Good evening, everyone. And
might not be good evening, because some people might be watching this at 3 o'clock in the morning.
It's still kind of evening-ish.
Okay.
But we're taping in the morning.
But we don't watch it in the morning.
Sometimes I do.
So if you're DVRing us, good whatever time of day it is. See what I have to put up with?
And even worse, this show appears in May, but we're taping in April. Time travel.
Yeah, okay, fine. Here, sleep. Okay, good. All right, our first film this month is Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs 2. It's the sequel to the highly successful Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs.
Yes.
And it's an animated film, and it stars the voice talents of Bill Hader from Saturday Night Live and James Caan. And this film is coming out in September of this year, and this looks pretty good. Main character of the film, and I can't remember his name off the top of my head, but he's been recruited by a big company. It's a kind of an homage to Jurassic Park.
Right.
So it looks really funny, and let's take a look at the footage, and you just decide for yourself.
My son, Flint Lockwood, always loved to invent things.
Cheeseburger!
Sometimes his inventions were great, and other times, well, not so much.
Ah, help! Help! Help!
We had to leave Swallow Falls so things could get cleaned up. But when we returned, something big was left over.
I can't believe my machine created all of this.
Are those chimpanzees?
Butter.
Look, mosquitoes.
Perfect.
Those are some tasty looking jellyfish.
Hungry.
It's enough to make a grown man cry. But not this man. Get back in there, Tia.
This September.
Did you hear something?
What was that?
Taco Dial Supreme.
It's no picnic.
Hold on, everyone!
Ah, there's a leak in the boat!
Saving the world.
We have to shut down the machine before the food animals get off the island and invade the mainland. All we have to do is cross the breakfast bog, brave the food animal jungle, and scale the Big Rock Candy Mountain. Piece of cake.
Mmm.
Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs 2.
I think I'll name him Barry.
Sam, don't touch it. Put it down.
Seriously?
Yeah, I enjoyed the first one.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of fun.
The first one was really good, right. Especially like the little kid. I love strawberry.
Yeah, wasn't in 3D?
I believe it was.
Yeah, it was in 3D.
Of course, to me, everything's in 2D, but, you know, what are you going to do? Okay, our next film is called Despicable Me 2. Now, I know we've shown a preview for this before. This is a brand new trailer and stars the voice talents of Steve Carell. And this one tells you a lot more about what the movie's about than the last one. And the last one was very vague,
right,
and was just funny visual stuff. This one tells you a little bit more about what's going on in the story. So let's take a look at that.
Good night, Edith. Good night, Marc. Hold the horses. Who are you texting?
My friend Avery.
Avery. Avery. Is it a girl's name or a boy's name?
Does it matter?
No, it doesn't matter unless it's a boy.
I know what makes you a boy.
Who you do?
Your bald head.
Oh, yes.
Sometimes I stare at it and imagine a little chick popping out.
Good night, Agnes. Never get older.
Mr. Gru, Agent Lucy Wilde of the Anti-Villain League. You're gonna have to come with me.
Oh, sorry, I... Precise!
You know, you really should announce your weapons after you fire them. For example... Lipstick taser! Get in there!
Anti-Villain League, dedicated to fighting crime on a global scale. A new villain has surfaced. You know how a villain thinks. That's why we brought you here.
Pins and needles!
I am the league's director, Silas Ramsbottom.
Bottom.
Hilarious.
Are you really gonna save the world?
Yes, right, baby! Gru's back in the game with cool cars, gadgets...
How are they working?
...and weapons!
Now that looks really good. The first one, Despicable Me, I loved.
Oh, those minions are just something else. Mm.
They are. They are hilarious. Absolutely hilarious. And there's a guy in there in the thing. Well, you saw the clip. I'm not going to repeat what you just saw.
It was fun.
It was funny. Mm. Next is a film that I'm really personally looking forward to. It stars, Jesse Eisenberg, Mark Ruffalo, and Woody Harrelson. And this one comes out on May, which is appropriate
enough. This month, yep.
It's playing this month. It comes out at the end of this month. So it's actually May 31st, you know, Memorial Day time. But this one is called Now You See Me, and it's about the Four Horsemen who are a group of illusionists who pull a series of amazing heists all around the world. And they are absolutely stymieing the FBI, who has a special task force that's looking into all of these heists and stuff. And it's just a great looking film visually. Mm. And I'm really looking forward to it. It is science fiction and it's not science fiction, but it still qualifies to be on the cool list on the show. So let's take a look at that and see what you think.
Come in close, because the more you think you see, the easier it'll be to fool you.
Ladies and gentlemen,
for our final trick,
we are going to rob a bank.
On the count of three, you will be teleported through space and time to your bank in Paris.
One, two,
three. Every
everyone in this room was a victim of hard times.
Some of you lost your homes, your cars,
and so tonight,
we're going to return some of that money back to you.
Thank you, everyone. We are the Four Horsemen.
Good night.
Your bank was the distraction while they set up the real trick.
I was $140 million distraction.
Who doesn't love a good magic trick?
FBI! Hands where I can see him.
I don't think I heard you correctly. Did you say magicians robbed the bank?
You are going to be played, right?
You have what we in the business like to call nothing up your sleeve. Because if you did, it means that you and the FBI and your friends at Interpol actually believe in magic. And then... first rule of magic, always be the smartest guy in the room.
One, two, three, and...
You want to know how they did it? Say the magic word.
A year ago, these guys were a bunch of street magicians.
Now they're pulling off amazing robberies and not keeping a single cent for themselves.
You do realize this is a game played out on a global scale. Vegas was just a start. This trick was designed a long time ago.
We are dealing with something far bigger than us.
We're all here for the same reason.
We cannot quit now.
Expose them now and destroy them.
Whatever is about to follow, whatever this grand trick is,
please,
is really going to amaze. Look closely, because the closer you think you are, the less you'll actually see.
That looks cool.
Okay. So is it more like mystery type horror?
It's an adventure.
Adventure.
Yeah, that's a new word. Adventure. Yes.
I like it.
It's an adventurous invention.
Okay,
and last but not least, Hugh Jackman reprises his role as the Wolverine in the self-titled film The Wolverine.
Hmm.
In this story, Wolverine is taken to Japan. Now, some of my favorite X-Men comic episodes with Wolverine was when he went to Japan.
Right.
And they're playing off of that. It looks like, and I'm going out on a limb, don't replay this later on and say, aha, you were wrong, because
no
I'll
promises.
Admit,
no
I,
promise.
I make no promises that I am correct on this.
Okay.
I'm just saying that from the previews, it looks as though they've really taken their time with this film and have done everything really well, like the special effects and the story, and just the first appearance of Hugh Jackman as Wolverine in the film looks really appropriate to the troubled man and what he's going through and everything.
Yeah, so it makes up for the previous Wolverine.
Just the preview makes up for the previous Wolverine.
Okay.
Well, and it, considering they've taken a lot of the story or elements of the story from the really definitive Wolverine miniseries back in, 1982 with Chris Claremont and Frank Miller, and the Silver Samurai is in it.
Yep.
And it does look really, really good.
And he's facing a whole cadre of villains in this, and he's given the choice as to whether or not he wants to become human and essentially mortal. Because he, as far as I know, he's one of the first mutants that's ever existed.
Yeah.
According to the Marvel Universe. So, anyway, you judge for yourself. I think it's going to look really good, and I think it's going to be a good film. But let's take a look, and like I said, you make the decision.
Trying to find you for over a year. It's an honor to meet the Wolverine.
That's not who I am anymore.
For many years, I have wanted to thank you for saving my life. I didn't send for you only to thank you, Logan. I wanted to repay you. A gift to equal the life you gave me. You have struggled long enough. I can end your eternity. Make you mortal. What they did to me, what I am, can't be undone. Don't be so sure. Healing.
Am I right, or did that look cool?
I think you are correct, sir.
Okay.
It is. Yep.
Yeah?
Good. All right.
Just another one in a long line of movies we're going to go see.
Oh, absolutely.
Yep.
Moving right along, it's now one of our favorite segments on the show because we like to keep up on what's going on with technology and the gaming universe. Calvin Watts with Game Over.
Well, I hope you'll be able to say that after the end of this segment because, you know, I haven't done this in a couple of months, and there's some ranting that's about to be going on.
Let the rant begin.
So we'll start with home video like we usually do.
Right.
And I want to preface this that I usually get my information from Bill Hunt's wonderful website, The Digital Bits. He's been always on top of the whole DVD/Blu-ray thing from back in the late 90s. And it's a wonderful website, digitalbits.com, you should check it out. So, Sony this month is going to come out with 4K mastered Blu-rays. Now, I mention this because now the TV manufacturers are starting to come out with, they're developing 4K television displays. 4K is basically the resolution that you have now currently in your movie theaters. So if you remember from the early 2000s, Sony did something like this called Superbit.
Right.
With the DVDs. So basically, they were able to remaster a DVD with video, and then it had like a higher resolution, higher bit rate, so a higher streaming rate. So it had top quality audio and video. So middle of May, the first batch titles are coming out, and among those that you might be interested in would be Ghostbusters, the Tobey Maguire first Spider-Man, The Amazing Spider-Man, so the new one, Battle Los Angeles for some reason, and Total Recall 2012. My point is, if they've had this ability, but it's only going to be in 1080p, so it's not going to actually be remastered in 4K. It's just, like I said, it's just optimized. My point is, if they had the ability to do this all along, why haven't they done it all along? You know, it's just another way to dig into the consumer and make you pay more. The other thing is the Oz, was it All Great and Powerful?
Yes, I saw that. Oz is Great and Powerful.
So that right now is currently, for the moment, 2013's number one movie. And so Disney is getting ready to come out with its all home video release. And it looks really interesting. They're gonna come out with a 3-day Blu-ray single disc. They're going to come out with a 2D Blu-ray single disc. They're going to come out with a 2-day Blu-ray/DVD combo disc, and then just your standard DVD, and they'll all have digital copy.
I'm confused. Okay.
My point is, the 3D digital copy slash Blu-ray is coming out, has an SRP of $44.99, and it's coming out alone. Before, with the 3D stuff, what they've been doing is, at that price, you would get a 3D Blu-ray, but you'd also get the 2D Blu-ray, you'd get the DVD, you'd basically get everything in all one package. Now, they've basically taken everything out of there, except for the digital copy, but they're still charging the same price.
Right.
Which is ridiculous.
Well, that's Disney.
Selfish bastards.
Uh-huh. And once Disney follows, everybody else is going to follow suit because right. you know it's going to sell. And it's ridiculous.
And then they're going to lock it in the vault so they'll be able to get it again until like 2039 or something. Yeah.
You know, and people who really get into enjoying the technical aspect of these movies and stuff, it's all getting pushed by the wayside. Mm. And, you know, this it's part of cinema that eventually we're starting to lose because everybody knows eventually they want to go towards just downloads only.
Right.
And all this extra stuff is just going to go by the wayside. Mm. And it sucks. But what are you going to do? Moving on to gaming, PAX East 2013 was a lot of fun.
Good.
I was slightly disappointed in the fact that they didn't really have much there for the PlayStation 4, and because we're in between that and they haven't officially announced a new Xbox yet, so there was a lot of stuff that was there that wasn't really new. In fact, the Xbox booth was basically showing off like new map packs for like Halo 4, the new Gears of War that just came out, and they had like a Dance Central set up.
Okay.
Which I found really interesting since Harmonix just came out and said there was no more Dance Central stuff coming out, but we'll get to that in a minute. But still, it was a lot of fun. They had a old-time arcade set up with a bunch of old-school video games, so that's always fun to play. And just the social aspect of PAX East is just a lot of fun. I cannot stress it enough. If you are a gamer, you need to go. And once they start selling tickets for 2014, buy them right away because they will sell it fast out. And sure. then you will be sorry.
Hmm. Now they don't deal just with video games either. They deal with all kinds of gaming, don't they?
Oh God, no. Yeah, absolutely. There's a huge tabletop thing going on.
They do RPGs.
They got handheld card games.
Nice.
They got tournaments going on. So it's not just video games, although primarily video games are the focus, but every Saturday night they have a big concert with a bunch of like people that are known for doing like songs that are based in video games. And it's a lot of fun.
It's cool.
Definitely recommended. One of the games that I was unsure of that I decided to go out and pay off right away was the Injustice DC fighting game.
Oh yeah.
I got to see a lot of that.
Yeah, they had a lot of buzz about that one.
And I was impressed enough to go and get it. So that's coming out as we speak this week, so I'm looking forward to playing that.
Okay.
Hopefully, it'll be better than Aliens Colonial Marines, which has been universally bagged as one of the worst games of the year.
Right.
And it's really sad because, you know, the first time I got to see anything was this was the PAX from last year. But it is such a bad game. I mean, I like it, but the only reason why I'm even into it is because it's the sequel to the Aliens movie.
Yeah, and you said last month that it was considered canon.
It's actually part of the Aliens universe,
right.
Allegedly. And the storyline is what's carrying it, but I mean, the gameplay is awful. AI is awful. The aliens should be, like, jumping out at you from, like, you know,
everywhere.
Corners and everywhere, and they should be, like, scaring the crap out of you.
Right.
They shouldn't be just dropping down right in front of you so you can just shoot
blow
them
away.
With a blaster. The gameplay is so 5 years ago.
Did they aim it toward a younger audience? Is that why
no,
they did
it's
it?
No, it's just been developed for a long, long time. Think of the Duke Nukem fiasco from a couple of years ago. I mean, that was in development for over a decade, and it showed. This has been in development for over, this was announced in like 2006, 2007.
Right.
And it showed.
So what started off as probably a really good game just got watered down over the years.
Uh-huh. And it's just really bad. And it's really funny how completely on the opposite spectrum is just how great BioShock Infinite is.
Oh, yeah.
I cannot stress this enough. Right now, easily game of the year. And anybody who's even into action-adventure games or single-player shooting games, anything, run and pick this up.
Is that an Xbox exclusive?
No.
It's not?
Multi-platform.
Okay.
So it's also available for the PS3 and I believe also for the PC as well.
That's good. I love it when they do that because you see so many games come out that are just an Xbox exclusive or PS3 exclusive, and it really just it frosts my Cheerios, to tell you the truth, because you know, there are people out there who can only afford one gaming system, and they're being cheated out of the gaming experience, you know, when they only put it on one platform.
Yeah, so. Some of the best games are only available for that one platform.
Right,
yep.
And it's difficult. I mean, this has been, And upcoming will be the first generation of systems that I haven't bought all of them for. I didn't rush out and buy a Wii U, and I have no intention of buying one anytime soon.
A lot of people aren't.
You know, so maybe when the new Zelda comes out, or if the price drops down to a much more manageable thing, I'll consider it then. But even with the new PlayStation that's coming out, you know, I've talked about it on a previous show. I'm not that impressed with what they've released so far. And, you know, I was all about the Xbox. Not now. And I say this because since we're taping in May, the rumor is right now on May 21st that Microsoft's going to have a small event, and that's when they're going to announce the new Xbox.
So we'll get all the specifics?
Yes. But I'm bringing this up because over in the past couple of weeks, Adam Orth, who was a former creative director at Microsoft Game Studios, recently either resigned or was canned because he got into a rant on Twitter about consoles or equipment being always on, because of the biggest rumor going on right now with the new Xbox is it's going to need an internet connection to function.
Right.
So what that basically means is if you don't have an internet connection, you can't play the thing.
Right.
It won't function, period. And that is just absolutely wrong. If anything, if you look at the recent fiascos that on the PC end, that Diablo 3 and SimCity have caused,
right,
because SimCity's always on, and you know the servers crashed and the game was unplayable, and you have all these people who spent hard-earned money and they can't play the thing. And don't get me wrong, I don't have a problem with the consoles being an all-in-one entertainment hub. I actually think it's really cool. I watch a lot of Netflix on my Xbox 360 and my PS3 when I put it on. And the applications and stuff for it are a lot of fun. And I think having an all-in-one entertainment hub is the way to go. So being online and having it optimized to having your system online is great. But what if you don't want to go online? What if something happens and they're working on the internet in your neighborhood and it's going to be down for a day?
Right.
So you're telling me that my console that I spent hard-earned money on is going to be a brick? Because that's what they're basically telling me. Now, you guys know I'm into classic games. So I have Ataris, I have Intellivisions, I have an Atari 2600 that was built in 1977.
Yep.
I can hook up to my nice plasma TV and it'll work. I'm sure somewhere in my basement or somewhere I have a Pong system from like 1973 that with a little modification from Radio Shack, I could hook up to my TV and I can still play that thing, and it's almost 40 years later.
I have a Sega Genesis that I haven't hooked up in my basement, and I play with that all the time.
Oh yeah, that's a great system.
Yeah.
So my point being, if this Xbox is required to have an internet connection to function, and the main reason why they're thinking about doing this is because they're talking about not being able to use used games on the system. And nothing, I want to stress, nothing has been put forth into that fact. But backwards compatibility and all this stuff aside, if this is the case, then what you're buying basically is something that within 10 years of it coming out, it's going to be a brick.
Right.
It's not going to work, because eventually they're going to come out with something new and they're going to shut off the servers and stuff for the old system, and then what? It won't function.
Right.
Nothing that you buy for that system will work. All of the games that you bought for it will not work.
So the future is disposable gaming systems? Is that what they're coming down to?
I don't know. I don't know where they're going with this. So my point is, if it's optimized to be online and you want it to be online, that's fine. But, you know, if I want to play my games offline, I want that option. And if Microsoft and Xbox isn't going to allow me to do that, as much as I said before, I wasn't really impressed with the PS4, at least I can do that with that machine. And I know 20 years from now, if I want to play that machine, I'll still be able to. But that guy got fired because he ranted on basically saying, well, you know, there's nothing wrong with always on. And then he started blasting people because a friend of his who was an engineer over at BioWare, started talking back and forth. And he's like, well, I mentioned about the SimCity thing and whether or not that made a difference.
Yep.
And what about people that don't have a really strong broadband internet connection? And you mentioned, I think, Blacksburg, Virginia, and something else. And the guy's like, well, why would I want to live there? Well, that's nice.
No.
Yeah, except for the people that are there. You know, there are a lot of people that buy gaming systems that don't have a broadband internet connection.
Right.
You know, as great as it is, I mean, if you go to like other places in Europe, you go to Japan, their internet connections destroy ours.
Right.
They have the infrastructure in place. I mean, I just read a report on Google maybe doing something with a high speed, really high speed broadband internet connection.
Was
and Austin's
going to
be
Texas.
Like a test market, but they're estimating conservatively that in order to do that nationwide would cost upwards of $100 billion. Mm. So I'm telling you right now, Microsoft, like I said before, has a really good chance to put themselves in the position to win this console generation.
Mm.
Or they're going to put themselves in the position to really shoot themselves in the foot and in the ass.
Mm.
So
I would worry if I had to have an internet connection for my gaming system. I would worry that some twisted maniac out there is going to come up with some kind of an internet bomb.
Oh, hack into
that's
it.
Going to hack into the system and all of a sudden send out some kind of a pig down the line that's going to destroy my system.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you won't have the option of disconnecting because you won't know what's coming.
Yeah. So it's all stuff to take a look at. So obviously next month, if they announce anything for this month, we will report it next month.
Mm-hmm.
And or, you know, in the June or July episode. And E3 is coming. So either way, soon enough, we'll know exactly what their plans are. And then we'll go from there. That's all I got.
Sounds good.
Excellent.
All right. Let's move on to a segment we like to call Toob News. Yeah, wonderful world of television. Yay. Here we go. Okay.
With Marc Morisseau.
With Marc Morisseau. That's me. The CW cancels Rodney O'Bannon's Cult after 7 episodes. Even a move from Tuesdays to Fridays couldn't save the stories. The CW aired 7 of the 13 episodes, and there are no plans to release the remaining shows.
That's a shame. I've watched several of those episodes, and I've got quite a few on my DVR right now. That was a really interesting show.
Was it good? I never saw it.
It was really good because you get dragged into the story, and it's one of those stories where it's a story about a story.
Okay.
And real life is mirroring what's going on in the show itself.
Okay.
And the line starts to get blurred between what's really going on and what's supposed to be scripted going on. And it messes with your head.
Yeah.
And I think maybe that's the reason that it got canceled, because too many people were getting confused.
It was too good.
Well, if you miss an episode,
will get a cult following. Yeah.
Yeah. If you miss an episode, you are really lost on this thing.
We'll probably appear on Netflix.
Yeah, I'm sure eventually it will.
Most likely.
Okay. Stephen S. DeKnight, the showrunner for Starz's Spartacus series, and also a writer on Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Angel, and Dollhouse, is bringing an alien-style series to premium cable, to Starz. The new series currently in development is called Incursion. The show will also count amongst influences Aliens, Halo, Band of Brothers, and Black Horn Down. But what's it about? DeKnight describes it as a war show that just happens to be against aliens on other planets. And yes, there's a female lead.
Wow, a female lead.
A female lead. So we'll see what happens. Ripley returns. The Sci-Fi Channel is up to shenanigans again.
Shenanigans.
They got some new stuff coming up. New shows are going to premiere this summer. One on Tuesday, August 27th at 10 p.m. is called Cosworld. Cosworld, that's a working title, okay? Cosworld is a 6-episode docuseries that highlights the imaginative world of cosplay competition. The series follows some of the hottest cosplay stars as they make a splash at comic book conventions around the country. So think Face Off for cosplay.
Right.
They have weekly competitions and whoever wins gets cash prizes.
Well, I mean, they do that at the conventions anyway, don't
they?
Yeah, but it's something that you're starting to see take off. I noticed we had talked about before we started taping about the Rhode Island Comic Con.
Right.
One of the guests appearing there, and I forget her name, but it's one of the more well-known cosplayers.
Mm. Yep.
So they definitely do have a following, and it's something that's really has gotten more prevalent in the past few years.
Well, I've been into costuming since,
you were a wee little lad.
Yeah, well, I mean, since I first started going to conventions back in 76 or 77.
Right.
And well, you're ancient.
Huh? I mean, so I've been costuming, like I said, since the 70s.
Yep.
And I mean, I've done everything from Star Trek to original costumes, yep, to Battlestar Galactica, the original.
You were in robot diapers, yeah.
I did not have robot diapers.
Oh, okay.
I had a robot change my diapers.
Pull-ups, okay.
That was, yeah, there you go. So.
How do you think underoos got invented? All right, so that cosplay show is coming up. They're also doing two miniseries based on classic SF films. And please don't screw the pooch on this Sci-Fi Channel. They've greenlit miniseries based on Larry Niven's Ringworld, which they've done before.
Yep.
And they're also doing Arthur C. Clarke's Childhood's End. Please don't mess this up.
Don't mess up Childhood's End.
Ever since I read Childhood's End in high school, I've been wanting a miniseries or a movie based on that. It would be so fracking awesome.
Yes.
So I have a very good suggestion to you.
Okay.
Don't bother watching.
Don't bother watching him.
Because come on, do you really think after everything they've done over the past like two or three years, they're actually going to do something
good? I don't
good?
Know. One can hope.
I just,
know?
Every time I hear Sci-Fi
Channel
yeah. series, I think of Super Shark versus Giant Octopus.
Yes. You.
And that's what it's known for. Yep, the Saturday night really schlocky movies, which are all right. They have their place, but not if that's the only thing you're doing. So we'll see. So Michael DeLuca, who did The Social Network, is putting together a Childhood's End project. And Michael Perry, who did The River Paranormal Activity 2, is going to be doing the four-hour Ringworld project. So okay. We'll see what happens.
Okay? My big question is, why do they have people who are not normally known for doing science fiction or speculative fiction movies? You know, they're doing... The guy doing Social Network is doing Ringworld, is it?
Right.
Why? What does he know about sci-fi?
No, he's doing Childhood's End, but who knows?
Well, what does he know about sci-fi? I mean, you've got to have somebody who knows sci-fi doing sci-fi.
Right.
Well, I might be wrong, but Michael Perry sounds like the former actor that was in, like, Eddie and the Cruisers and the Philadelphia Experiment and Speak of Fire.
No, it's not the same spelling.
It's not the same guy?
No, it's not the same guy.
Never mind.
Okay.
I tried.
That's all right. I understand. The mystery of Doctor Who's companion Clara continues. Here's a little trivia fact for you guys. Victorian Clara's birth date, the one from the Snowman Christmas episode, happens to be the same date that Doctor Who premiered in 1963, November 23rd.
Oh, wow.
So there's a little bit of useless information that you can get here. All right?
So did they do that as an homage because this is the 50th year of
Doctor
Who? Because
it's the 50th year of Doctor Who.
Cool.
Yes. They're also speculating that Clara herself, because she's seen in multi-dimensions and multi-time periods, has something to do with tying into the 50th anniversary special.
Oh, wow.
Which would be kind of neat, I think. Excuse me.
Now, do we know how many doctors have already signed on for the 50th?
So far, we've got David Tennant.
Yeah.
We have Billy Piper, the companion.
Yeah.
Freema Agamemnon, whatever her name is.
Freema Agamemnon.
Yeah, she's not able to do it. There were rumors about, was it Colin Baker, who's a sixth doctor?
Yeah.
He kind of hinted that he might and might not. He's kind of being coy about it. And then Sylvester McCoy, who played the seventh doctor, he was interviewed and said he might be doing it too. We know that Christopher Eccleston is not going to be doing it.
Okay.
Oh, and we haven't heard anything from Tom Baker.
Okay.
So we don't know.
Tom Baker's really getting up there too. He's getting kind of long in the tooth.
Yeah.
But I hope that he's there because he was one of my favorite doctors.
Yeah, he was one of the longest running.
He's the one who really brought it to the States. Yeah. So.
Yep.
Yeah, I watched an old Third Doctor John Pertwee episode a couple
That was
ago.
Great.
That was
really fun to see
that.
That
was a lot of fun. All right, some non-related, well, kind of sort of TV news. Fox shuts down anyone selling a Firefly Jane hat. Ripple Junction is a company that produces licensed apparel. They obtain the rights to mass produce the Jane hat. Remember that funky cap that he wears? It instantly became a hit seller on the popular nerd sites like ThinkGeek. It seemed that getting a Jane hat was easier than ever, but that ease came with a price. Turns out in the last few weeks, many fans crafting and selling their hats on art sites like Etsy have received cease and desist letters or have simply been banned from Etsy for producing do-it-yourself Jane hats. This communal endeavor, it seems, is coming to a close, and fans of the show are asking themselves, why? Isn't the whole point of a Jane hat that it be homemade? Because in the episode, which by the way is one of the episodes that never aired, you had to get it in the CD, the DVD set, supposedly it was made by his mom. So all these people that were crafting these Jane hats and selling them on Etsy, everyone is made a little bit different to give it that mother homemade type feel to it, which is pretty cool. So the bottom line is you can make a Jane hat for yourself or your friend, you just can't sell them anymore. And in response to all the upset Firefly fans, Think Geek wrote a blog post about the incident and explained their stance on the situation. And they also announced that 100% of the profits from their Jane hat sales for their current stock is going to go to the Can't Stop the Serenity charity, the global charity that Whedon founded for
Equality Now,
which we ran a couple years ago. We did a fundraiser for the Serenity Now. So until the stock runs out, all the hats, all the Jane hats that Think Geek produces is going to go to that.
I have a simple solution. Charity. Don't promote it as a Jane hat. Just promote it as a sci-fi hat.
Right.
And they can't stop you because each hat is individual. You're not going to, it's not like you're taking something and reproducing something exactly from a mold that was in the thing.
Right.
And you know that the producers of Firefly did not go out and have somebody specifically make a hat for that. They just sent somebody sent a buyer out and grabbed a hat from a head store or from whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Fox is getting greedy. They decided, even after 10 years, they've decided to pull a cease and desist. Oh, well. Orphan Black is a new BBC America series that follows Doctor Who on Saturdays at 9. Orphan Black features Titania Maslany in the lead role of Sarah, an outsider and an orphan whose life changes dramatically after witnessing the suicide of a woman who looks just like her. Sarah assumes her identity, her boyfriend, and her bank account, but instead of solving her problems, the street-smart chameleon is thrust headlong into a kaleidoscope mystery. She makes the dizzying discovery that she and the dead woman are clones, but are they the only ones? Hmm. It's a really well done series. We watched it after the premiere of Doctor Who.
Yep.
As we tape, this is going to be episode number 3, and it's really good.
It is. Hmm.
It's really well done. It's worth checking out. Okay, some other news. Comic artist Carmine Infantino died on April 4th. He was 87 years old. He was one of the greatest artists in the Silver Age comics history.
Yep.
He was an artist for both DC and Marvel. He did The Flash, he did Superman, he did just about everything.
Yeah, well known for The Flash, well known for Green Lantern.
Yep.
Yep.
Very well known and very, like you said, one of the definitive, if not the definitive artist for DC at least during that time.
Yep.
Good stuff. From what I understand, he was very approachable when he made convention.
When he went to conventions, he wouldn't charge for autographs. If you wanted something signed by him, here you go. And you're all set to go. Good.
Yep.
And then Ian Banks, who's an author of the Crow Road and Wasp Factory, has announced that he's dying of cancer. He's only 59 years old.
That's a shame.
And he recently married his longtime 42-year-old girlfriend, which is kind of neat. As we tape, they're honeymooning in Italy.
Mm-hmm.
And he's putting the finishing touches on his book, The Quarry, which is due out in June. So he expects that to be his last novel ever, which is kind of sad because I understand, I've never read his work, but I understand he's a very good writer.
Yep.
And he's touched base on science fiction, but he's also done some other work as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And if I can add two more names to that list, really. Rest in peace, Annette Funicello.
Yes.
Who was a founding member of the original Mickey Mouse Club.
And we were mentioning before the show a class act.
Mm-hmm. Yes, very class act, very classy lady. She was a childhood sweetheart of mine because I used to watch her in the old Beach Blanket movies with Frankie Avalon and stuff like that.
Oh, you didn't like her because of the ears.
The ears didn't bother me. And also, rest in peace, one of the funniest men I've ever seen in my life, Jonathan Winters.
Jonathan Winters, God bless.
He was...
If it wasn't for Jonathan Winters, there'd be no Robin Williams.
That's probably just it, because Jonathan Winters was the original, I have to call him a gonzo comic, because he was just so off the cuff and spontaneous with his humor.
Yep.
So, and he his connection to sci-fi, if you want to know. He played Mork's son on Mork and Mindy.
On Mork and Mindy, back in the 70s.
Yep.
Good stuff. Okay. All right, and that's it for Toob News for this month. Usually in the summertime, there are tons and tons of conventions that you can go to. So here's a list of conventions that you might want to check out. And now it's time for Toys, Props, and Other
Stuff.
Oh, that was a good one. Where we talk about the wonderful world of science fiction collectibles. Okay, what's
how exciting.
Really swell. Let's see first. Harvey Birdman. Yes, that's a three.
Attorney at Law.
Attorney at Law. What a funny set series that was on DVD. And next to that is Men into Space. That's an autobiography type book about the 1959-1960s TV show. And that was written by a local author, John Fredrickson, right?
Yes. From Smithfield?
From Smithfield, yes. Hello, yes. John. So go buy his book. Look it up on Amazon or something. It's really awesome. Next to that, let's see. On the right, we have Flash Domo, which is pretty cool. I like I like Domo. Cool. He's cool. They also have two versions of Batman. They have a Green Lantern and they have a Superman. But I thought Flash was the most colorful, so I got him.
Very cool.
All right. Next to that, go ahead, guys. Somebody else talk.
Don't look at me. I can't read the screen.
Next to that is The Physics of Star Trek, which is a book that came out in, I believe, in the late 80s, early 90s.
Discusses what does work and what doesn't work according to the laws of
transporters,
physics.
Transporters, warp drive, phasers, the whole nine yards. Okay. Next to that is Gentry Lee's Bright Messengers, which is an awesome book. And next to that is Prehistoric Park, with Mr. Nigel himself. That's a BBC video series. You can also catch it online. And that's where paleontologist Nigel goes back into time and he captures prehistoric animals and he brings them back into the present. And along the way, you learn a lot of science facts about dinosaurs. It's a really good series. I mean, I've even used it in school where I work with the kids to learn about dinosaurs and prehistoric
pets. That must
keep
them interested.
It does. They loved it.
Cool.
They couldn't get enough.
Okay, I want you to repeat after me.
After me.
Amazon is evil.
Amazon is evil.
Amazon is evil.
What you are looking at.
What you are looking at.
Are the complete collections.
Can I stop?
Okay, you can stop now. Okay. What you're looking at are the complete collections of the Star Trek movie series. On the left is the original motion picture stuff. So basically from Star Trek the motion picture through Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country.
Do they purposely exclude 5?
No, they 5 should. Is in there.
Okay.
And on the right are the Star Trek Next Generations one from First Contact and Generations through to Nemesis.
Hmm.
I have both of these because they went like the gold box, like one day or one week special. And
right.
I spent around like $4 per movie.
So it's like the QVC of sci-fi.
So it's like the QVC of stuff. Each one has like a special disc that has like extra stuff that's only available in these sets. And a lot of stuff has been remastered. Plus, in the case of the original, it's also the first time that Star Trek VI and the motion picture have been released on Blu-ray in the theatrical format.
Nice.
So definitely worth checking out.
Good.
And my pick right now for Game of the Year, BioShock Infinite. I cannot say enough good things about this game. It is not multiplayer, so if you're looking for a multiplayer game, forget it. But if you're looking for a very intriguing, engaging single-player experience,
right,
definitely get it. It will make you think. The ending is mind-blowing. Mm. Definitely worth every penny.
The Popular Science had an article about the science you would need to hold up a city, float a city with between combination of balloons and rockets, like mm-hmm. in the thing. It's impossible. Can't do it. All right, what else we got?
And this is also Gears of War Judgment, an Xbox 360 exclusive. I was a little worried because it being like a prequel and stuff that they were just throwing out another Gears of War game.
Which one is that in the series?
It's the fourth one in the series, but it's set before all of them.
Yep.
And yeah, it's another Gears of War game, but it has enough changed to it that the single player has been very engaging. Mm-hmm. Multiplayer is still just as fun as ever. And it has my stamp of approval.
Very nice.
Worth picking up.
If it's got the Calvin stamp of approval, it's an awesome game.
Cool.
That's right. Okay.
Very cool.
If you want to get into any shout outs before we go? Anybody want to mention, say hi to anybody or?
I would like to mention, give a shout out to all of our fans at East Providence High School, as well as some of you might know, I drive a school bus for the city.
Yep.
And I recently went with my daughter Sarah to meet the teachers. Think she's going to be entering high school in the fall.
That's right.
And she found that there are a few people in there, students as well as faculty, that watched the show.
Very nice.
And she was pleasantly,
hello,
or unpleasantly surprised.
But, hello, Townies. Nice to meet you.
I am a Townie, and there are people who watch the show here where we tape in East Providence, and I appreciate it. So thank you very much.
Sounds good. Okay. If you want to get in touch with us, let's see. Our website is www.risfc.org. We have information about Sci-Fi Journal. We have information about Rhode Island Science Fiction Club meetings. We would love to see you at a meeting. Our next meeting is going to be in June. We're going to Cold State Park, have a nice little pikinika out there. So we post information about that stuff. Pikinika?
Yeah, it's a picnic where we roast pickanies.
Okay. And we also have a Facebook page.
The bad jokes have got to go, guys.
I know.
Address all of your complaint letters to me. Care of Sci-Fi Journal.
Yep. So we also have a YouTube channel. So if you're not able to watch us on Rhode Island Public Access, go to our YouTube channel. And can you become a fan? You can become a fan of YouTube channels, right? Become a fan of our YouTube channel. That would be wicked awesome, cool, and groovy. We would love you very much. All right. Next month, we have footage from Free Comic Book Day, so be sure to tune next month. Thank you very much for watching, and we will see you. Thanks.